Morning, friends.
Morning.
I'm going to draw on this one. I'm having trouble with my passport this morning, so the sermon will probably be blessedly short. And if I start to falter, the lovely Doug Lutz is volunteer to pick up the pace for me. I know Nancy can relate to this. I came out yesterday to the craft fair, and the church was buzzing, as was the city or the little village. How many of you were able to come by yesterday? Glad to see it. I know some of you were working, and some of you were in the kitchen, and some of you were greeters, so it's lovely to see so much activity going on in the church. I would ask Susan how things went, but I don't see Susan. She's probably tuckered out. Jerry, do you have announcements before you sit?
I think I saw almost everybody here in the Pittsburgh village to do a craft show, isn't it?
It does.
It was wonderful to see everybody here. I'm not sure how much we made for all the missions, but I'm sure it was great. The bake sale was good.
Jerry, Susan
upset tax and said it's $4,000. $4,000? Gosh, now we get 10% of that. Just kidding. Canned biscuits and stew were great. Some really good announcements. One is to have Cindy Bush back in attendance. All those who helped in the kitchen, Kathy and Martha and those that helped fill in for her. It's a wonderful, we talked about friendship in Sunday school this morning, how important that is for that. Another really good announcement. This morning, Martha and I were getting out of our car, coming up to church, and we picked up somebody in the parking lot. Michael Myers, right here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
He works at Langley, and he came to our Sunday school class this morning, so it's wonderful having him. Welcome back anytime. It really helped our Sunday school class, lowered our average age a little bit. So, but it's nice to have you. It's good to see everybody here this morning. Thank you all for everything you do. We'll be doing the lunches this month. Martha will be making the lunches. And we're going shopping tomorrow. So looking forward to everything. Thank you for your support.
Thank you, Jerry. Some of you have already placed your pledge cards in the offering plate. You will also have an opportunity as the usher comes forward during the time of prayer, Thanksgiving, and stopping, so that if anybody has one they want to drop in the basket, they're welcome to do so. It's not a mandatory requirement. You don't have to sprint up the altar. We're having Fifth Sunday brunch this morning. I know we just did all that stuff yesterday, and today will be a day of relaxation and potluck and fellowship. So if you can join us following worship, that would be fantastic. Dinner Church is having their gathering tomorrow night down the road. Halloween is on Tuesday, and my understanding right now is it's supposed to rain and be cold. So make sure you have your umbrellas and your rain hats and all of those good things. The United Women in Faith are meeting on Monday. The Bible study is meeting on Monday morning. Is the Bible study meeting?
Yep.
Okay. 10:30, right?
Virtual.
Yes, virtual. Saturday, we're going to have a family meeting. And it's really important that all of you be present. We're We're going to go over the survey that we've just concluded. We've got some tremendous results. I was really pleased with the amount of surveys that were returned and the remarks that were made on some of the comments only. So we're going to go over all that. We're going to go over our next steps. So it's important that you be there for that because I can't take time during worship to go through church business. It's not the time or the place. So Saturday morning, 10 a.m. in the fellowship hall. Anybody else have an announcement? Okay.
Thank you.
Again, I welcome you to worship. I'm glad that you're here. If you would stand as you're able for our opening hymn, number 155, I'll have the call in Jesus' name. 154.
Amen. Testament lesson is found today in Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 through 12. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho, and the Lord showed him the whole land, Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, this is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over it. Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab at the Lord's command. He buried him in a valley in the land of Moab opposite Beth-Hur, but no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not faded. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt, against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land. And for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. Please join in the Psalter. It's number 809, Psalm 90.
Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us.
and as many years as we have seen evil.
Let your word be manifest to your servants, and in the glorious title to their children.
Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands.
Yes, establish the work of our hands.
But though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from the deceit or impure motives or trickery, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God, who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others. Though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ, but we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us.
Thank you. I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. Comes from Matthew, the 22nd chapter, verses 34 through 46. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them this question: "What do you think of the Messiah? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." And he said to them, "How is it then that David, by the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, 'The Lord is my God, the Lord is my Lord, sit at my right hand, and I will put your enemies under your feet'? If David thus calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one was able to give him an answer. Nor from that day did anyone dare ask him any more questions. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Eric, do you want to come up? Your family. That's a great answer.
They always call you family.
including Jesus and God, they're always praying for family. Isn't that a great answer? See, the thing is, I was going to say, God, you know, we love God first, but then we love our family, don't we? And then our friends and our teachers and, you know, down the line. We love our animals. We love pizza. We love ice cream. Yes. But they're not at the top, are they? No, they're not at the top. Yeah, they're not at the top. God's at the top. And God is the best image of love we can ever know. And so he asks us to go out into the world and love each other. And sometimes loving each other is hard. Have you ever been unlovable? Have you ever been a little bit rough around the edges? Yes. Has any of you been a little rough around the edges, friends? Somebody just said no. We all have been in those moments when we haven't been our best selves, but God still loves us. And that's good news for us today. That God will love us when we're our best selves and our not best selves every time in between. Yeah, that's good news. That's happy news. So then that helps us to love our family and love other people. Because God gives us strength and courage to do that. Yeah. You're going to say yes a lot, aren't you? Yeah. Will you pray with me? Okay. Gracious God, we thank you for Eric and all the children he represents. Thank you for your love that sustains us, gives us the strength to go on day after day. We ask you now to bless Eric, his family, his friends, his teachers, and all who love him as he loves them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Eric. So I've been thinking about this word love and how we banter it about. Sometimes we love pizza, right? Sometimes we love shrimp and grits. Not me personally, but some people do. Think of all the things that you love in this world. And then think about this scripture where Jesus says, just as the Israelites heard it, hear, O Israel, hear, O people of God, the Lord your God is born, and you shall love him with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. Love God first, and then love other people, and other things, and other situations. And as I've thought about that, especially with the news this week of what happened in Maine, I thought, how do we love this man who was mentally ill and shot and killed so many people? How do we love him? Because we do, of course, pray and love for the victims and the families. We've heard tributes already. But how do we love the man who did this? How do we love the people in the world who are not their best selves? Just like as I asked Eric, there are times when we have not been our best selves. How then do we love each other? And the only thing I could come up with as I prayed this week was we love each other because God loved us first. That's the only answer that sustained me through the praying of this scripture this week. It's that God loved us first. And therefore, we can then love others better than we love objects, things, situations, football teams. You get the idea. God loved us first and best and set the perfect example for us in Christ Jesus. And in doing that, he showed us the way to go out into the world and love the lovable and the unlovable. Those who were their very best self and those who were not. How to love ourselves as well so that we could go out and show someone else what it means to be a child of God. But Jesus didn't stop there. He says, the second part of this is to love one another. Love God first, above everything. Love your neighbor. Love the stranger, love the enemy, as you love yourself and God. On this, he says, hangs all the law and the prophets, the law, the fulfillment of the Torah. The prophets, the words that came from wise men and women until Jesus himself came to teach us. What a gift it is to us that God loves us and sustains us and allows us to go out into the world to love other people. It's not enough to keep that love to yourself, is it? You have to do something with the love that God gave you because it's so abundant. It's so life-giving. And we must do something with it. And the scripture says we go out and love other people. It doesn't say we go out and like other people. Let me tell you, there's a difference between those two things, aren't there? Nobody agrees with me? Do you like everybody in the world? Do you like everybody in your neighborhood? Do you like everybody you work with? No, of course not. But somehow we have to transcend that like to get to love, even for those people. Maybe especially for those people we don't like. I told you about the bus driver when I was in seminary who would drive past me and my roommate, or drive so incredibly she would throw people off the seats. And I started praying for her because it's the only thing I could think to do. And once in 4 years, when I said, have a good day, she said, you too. I don't know what was going on in her life, but I knew she was a child of God, and something must have caused her to be an erratic driver, among other things. And so I took what love I had seen, and I shared it with this woman who did not know I was praying for her. Never told her. Never changed my behavior towards her. Always was polite and respectful because that's what love is. But there are people that it is harder to love. I mentioned Maine, I think of Gaza, I think of the children that lives have been lost both in Palestine and Israel. And the love that has been lost there. The war in Ukraine. All the places in the world where there is violence and harm going on, and yet somehow we're supposed to love each other through this. And it's not an easy thing sometimes. And yet God says it is the most important thing. It's to love God first, and then you can love others. Love God above everything, which is a challenge for us because we love so much stuff. And we love our families dearly. But God says, love me more. Because I am your only God, your only Lord, your only Savior. Love me more than you love all else. Love me first before all else. It's not easy. It sounds really simple when you just read the words and say them out loud. Just love God. Love your neighbor. And the rest will fall into place. The kindness, the compassion, the mercy, the forgiveness, the dignity and respect. It will all come. Because it comes out of the gift of love that God gave us, as I said, first. We didn't earn this love as if we could. I think sometimes we don't deserve this love, but he gives it anyway. I suppose I speak for myself there, I won't speak for you. But God says, love me first, love me best. And I know from personal experience that from then comes loving other people. The people you disagree with, the people you do agree with, the people you like, the people you don't like, the people that are different from you, the people who are same as you. Love God first and the rest will follow. Doesn't that sound just so simple, friends? Like just anybody could go out there and do it? And yet, for thousands of years, people have done it. And now, as the body of Christ, we do it in the places we live, and we work, and we play. Because God commanded it of us. And Christ reminds us of its importance. If you haven't read this passage in a while, go back and reread it. It happens, actually, on the Monday after Jesus goes into Jerusalem. I bet you didn't remember that. As he's preparing to go to the cross, the ultimate sacrifice of love for each of us. I can think of nothing better than to know God loved us first and best and will love us to the end. So may that be your good news today, your sustenance, your life, your thanksgiving. Amen.
Morning. So before the choir sings, we thought that it was important for you to hear some words from the composer of our anthem this morning. I was working on the Susan Bentzel Boorsman new lyric, Dwell in the Light Forevermore, on Friday, December 14, 2012, when a lone gunman burst into the Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut, inexplicably taking the lives of 20 young children and 6 adult staff. Within a matter of minutes. As news of this tragedy spread, I, like many, were devastated by the senseless loss of life. I found Susan's words to be a source of solace and hope that day. Through the valley of the shadows, lost in the dark of night, our God goes before us to lead us to the light. There will be no more night, no need for lamp, or ray of sun, the lamb will shine by the light. There will be no more night, no need to fast, to watch, to weep, around the throne so bright. My dear friend and mentor, the late Robert R. Reardon, president of Anderson University from 1958 to 1983, said to me several years ago, following the unexpected death of his wife, Geraldine, grief is a common journey we shall all share in life. Though none of us wish to take the trip, eventually we must all travel it. Pain and disappointment comes in many forms. Life is never scripted quite the way we would have chosen. But by faith, we know that God walks with us and goes before us, shedding light in our valley of shadows, longing to embrace us when we reach the end of the journey, be it long or short, with joyous words ushering into the eternal presence of Christ's holy light. Well done, well done. Be my good and faithful one. Come dwell in the light of life forevermore. This is the eternal hope to which we cling. So for all who grieve in the memory of the children and adults of Sandy Hook Elementary School, Newtown, Connecticut, December 14, 2012, the First United Methodist Church choir, dwell in the light forevermore.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as you are able for our affirmation of faith. We speak these words together and make them from the apostles and people in Romans 8:181. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and stood at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The next hymn, number 399, Take My Life and Let Me Be. We have glimpsed the promised land here, but not yet. We lift up those who live in the shadow of disappointment, having seen the promise but not the realization. You lift up those who live with a weight of responsibility, having carried the burden of another person's pain. You lift up those who live in the obscurity of loneliness, having survived torment that cannot be explained.
Thank you for all those receiving gifts on the news, and for those who are loving and promise.
Lay your holy hands upon us in power of God, that we may be the church for them through Christ who sustains us.
Amen.
And we pray together now as Jesus taught his disciples, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of God. Let me remind you that as Bill comes forward, if you have your pledge card, you may drop it into the offering plate. Would you please come forward? Bill. Holy God, we offer these gifts to you. May your favor be upon them and prosper in the labor of our hands, that your glorious power may be manifest to all through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Christ loves the church, and that's us. Would you stand as you're able and look for page 509?
Thank you.
renewal of Christ's church. Almighty, eternal, just, and merciful God,
grant us the desire to do only what pleases you, and the strength to do only what you command. Cleanse our souls, enlighten our minds, and inflame our hearts with your Holy Spirit, that we may follow in the footsteps of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Beloved family of God, be gracious and kind to all, with both the gentle acceptance of a child and the wise maturity of a compassionate mother. May the Lord bless you and lay loving hands upon you, that you may be strengthened to continue to walk in the faith that others have passed on to you, to move ahead into the promised land.
Amen.